effect on it? Why not? Okay.
Non-linearity. You know about linearity. I want to tell you the complete partition. First, we have a system. The ideal systems are distortionless systems. No distortion. What I have? I don't like to. Now. The impulse response. If this relation holds such a relationship, what does it mean? It means that the impulse response is a scaled and delayed version of my stimulus, of my output of response is a delayed and scaled version of my stimulus. The corresponding Fourier transform, this is the Fourier transform, the spectrum of this, the complex spectrum, we have the amplitude spectrum and the phase characteristic, the amplitude characteristic and the phase characteristic. The amplitude characteristic is completely flat for all frequencies. And the phase characteristic is exactly linear over all frequencies. This, if you have these properties, then you have a system without distortion. It means that if I have a long optical fiber or a coax fiber, coax cable, I put a rectangular pulse at the input, 100 kilometers at the receiver, I get a rectangular pulse out with a different scale and with a fixed delay. Then you have a distortionless system. That's what this means. Okay, that's what tells here. Flat amplitude linear phase. Of course, such a system doesn't exist. what you normally have is a system with linear distortion. This is normal. This is doesn't cause any problems. And this is what happens with, for example, with filters, analog filters and digital filters. This is what happens. You have here your impulse response, and I start now at the frequency response. I have here the amplitude characteristic, positive, and here I have the phase characteristic. Now, if I have the frequency spectrum of my input, which is a shifted into harmonic analysis. In fact, that is this is what I did all the time, forgot to tell. Nonlinear distortion analyzes you by using cosine or sine, complex or complex harmonics. So I put at the input a complex harmonic, so the spike, and then the response looks like this. And of course, this Dirac function has frequency selecting property, so I can replace all these f's by f0. So I get here the, in the amplitude spectrum, I get here the amplitude for f0, and I get here the phase shift for f0. And this is for each frequency, we have a different. The amplitude is different, and here, so the phase is, so this will not be a constant amplitude anymore, and this will not be a linear phase anymore, and that's what we call it linear distortion. It is a deviation from this linearity. Now, having it's not bad, because the that's what you see. You put one frequency in and you get one frequency out. So this is what filters do. If you put a signal through a filter, it makes a distinction between frequencies you want and frequencies you do not want, frequencies you suppress. That's a filter. A filter suppresses and pass and passes suppresses what the specific class of frequencies and passes another set of frequencies and discriminates a filter. Specific attributes and specific delay. This is what it says. But harmonic in, harmonic out.
No problem.
Now, nonlinear distortion. What happens then? Now, I go back to the time domain. What I said, and this was a demonstration I want to show, but okay. I put a harmonic in, and I do not get a single harmonic out. No, I get a whole sequence of harmonics out. The fundamental frequency, which is only linear distortion, but I get also the double frequency, the triple frequency, and so on. I get all the others as well. Now, from the before the break. So if that happens, then I have a non-linear system and I have, in this case, non-linear distortion in my response. And okay, this you recognize, of course, as the Fourier series that I have, and this is then a special case of the Fourier tone. Something happens here. I will investigate. Is it also on your slides? It's only my computer that's doing funny things. Julian, you have the slides? Is this also happening to you? Is art focused? No. Because if the formulas are different from yesterday.
I'm squatting from PowerPoint to video. So sometimes it might happen.
God, this is really shit. Okay, I will look again through all the slides and see what's happening. This okay, this is due to all these versions of all these formula editors and so, and they are not compatible. And software, I'd say software people only produce rubbish. That is okay, but that's my opinion. And this is this is proof number 100 for me. Okay. That might be the clue, yeah. Okay. If I do the Fourier transform of this, then I have here in the spectrum, we see a whole set of spectral lines which at equal distance. And this n is the degree of distortion. Eh? If n is 1, we have no distortion. It is, you will later see, IP1 line, and for 2 and 3, and we will not analyze beyond 3, 1 to 3, IP1, IP2, IP3 distortion, range of harmonics. Ah. okay, there's some more pictures, and I already saw when I inspected the slides yesterday, that this line should be here. I copied this, of course, I robbed this from the internet. And then you see, if you have a distortion in the system, this is your input-output relation. Eh? This is what you put in, you get out, and with the same scaling factor. Eh? The slope is a scaling factor. And if you put here a block wave, the output is also a block wave. And a harmonic, where is a harmonic? Now this one is a typical one of the examples of high pass filter. Electronic engineers immediately recognize if you have this capacitor is blocking for low frequencies and is a short circuit for high frequencies. So what it does, it distorts this block wave, the high frequencies at this steeple flank, they are passed, but if you wait longer, then the low frequencies are blocked. So this, and if I should swap this resistor and this capacitor, it would, it's like here, it's just the reverse. This one is blocking for high frequencies and short circuit for here the high frequencies are blocked, and the low frequencies are passed. So these are typically filters, four first order filters. But if you put the harmonic in, you still get the harmonic out. But frequency specific amplitude and a frequency specific time shift. And from this speaker's point of view. Now, this is from input output typical relationship of nonlinear distortion. In the block wave, you won't. You will experience also things. In a harmonic, you immediately see it. You have here, you had a sine wave, but the sine wave here is saturated, clipped. And here, this is a soft clipping. This is sort of an Arctangens curve. But this one is a hard clipping, which could happen in digital signal processing because you have a hard maximum. And then your harmonic becomes a sine wave which is clipped. If you compute the spectrum of this periodic signal, but not harmonic, you get a whole set of harmonics instead of one. Now, some examples from nature. It's not this. Okay, this is some German. This is not even from technical science. This is some more philosophical. And I told you again. I think the human perception and also animal perception works logarithmic. if you harsh sounds, the different soft sounds and two times as your sound the audio levels you express in decibels instead. This is a logarithmic scale instead of linear. This matches to what your eyes and especially what your ears do. And then you use the compounders, and we showed that yesterday at quantization, why in telephone transmission use this compression and then this expansion at the receiver. That it works quite well. Now the other biological processes, all biological processes are exponential. If you write Taylor sequence of this, then you can see that only the first term is a constant, 1 plus x, and then plus x squared divided by 2, x3 divided by 6, and so on. All these quadratic and third degree terms, they are non-linear. But normally, we neglect that and we linearize our models. So, everything we do, our mathematical models, are just poor approaches of what really happens in nature. Okay, this is the power series. This is some mathematical examples, and immediately you can see the linear systems that we have is only a very small subset of what from nature, and all the other systems are non-linear. You have here the power of m is non-linear, taking the square, the rectified harmonic, that is also non-linear, produces higher harmonics. Taking a logarithm, taking the exponential, cosines, arctangens, and this one, the sine function, if you have a system doing the sine function, that is extremely non-linear. Yes.
Okay, this is, I want to make a description of
a nonlinear amplifier, and what I do, I take this one, this one, this one, and the rest I neglect. And I do this with harmonic analysis. If the X is harmonic, then the stimulus is harmonic, then the out response is a linear combination of these harmonics, and this is two times the fundamental wave, three times the fundamental wave, and so on. But I truncate it here. And then you already see how hard the analysis will be. The books that all the books I've seen always the books that do this, the few books always go to the third degree of the and see appendix. Yes, that's where I do the computations now. I have to go to the appendix for doing the computations and forget about this part because I don't even want to see this trigonometric form I have explained to you. The complex phasor form. This is the part of the conclusion. If I have a cubic system, and this is this nonlinear amplifier, I have these coefficients of my distortion. I put one frequency in, and I get zero in, and I have DC voltage out and D3 out. This is linear distortion. What I can also do to check, this is very nice, you can put two frequencies in. Different frequency and take care that they're not multiples of one another, but for example 36 or and 59 kilohertz, so like this. And that they're not have a simple relationship. If you put that, and I will look for the pictures and give them the same amplitude, then the amplitude is already chaos, but what you then get is not only the linear distortion components, you also get the cross, the sum and the differences of the multiples of the frequencies. You do not only get non-linear distortion, you also get called intermodulation. And if you have this in the spectrum, you then get the chaos. And if you have a whole set of frequencies here, I can expect what you get here. And what I did for a solution, a solution that we had to do as students. If you have a whole set of frequencies and you put that on a non-linear amplifier, then instead of each frequency separately, you just put a white noise. Don't mind about the phase, but look at the amplitude. And then you see here how the white noise is colored for the linear components, like this one, this one, and this one. And the second order and the third order, and you see to what extent the noise is colored. And the white noise band limited, the second order response of white noise is a triangle, and the third order of the white noise is some quadratic curve. And if you continue that, you end up in a Gaussian curve, if you but I did it to the third. This is chaos if you have this. This is horrible. This is what happens. the validity of the relationship.
Yeah.
I think I first go to you. I want to show you the. The appendix.
Given this nonlinear amplifier with this input-output relationship, there's no convolution anymore because it's not valid. There's no what do you call it? Impulse response or anything. Forget about this. Now we have to put the stimulus at the input and measure the response at the output and make our own table. We put the harmonic at the input and I have here cosine, but it should be e to the power, a complex harmonic, and I get this at the output. The best thing to do is really use cosine and have cosine here. If I do it with complex harmonics, then the whole analysis becomes even more complicated. So I apply Chernyshev polynomials and have to rewrite each term, each multiple of this frequency. I have to rewrite the power of cosine. This is a nice exercise for mathematical students, by the way. If we evaluate the Chebyshev polynomials and I think in the two families. This is
a horrible formula editor, but
let's see. So the response, here you have the non-linear, the linear term. So this is good, this is a DC component. Here I have two terms for distortion. Now, here I have done some manipulation with trigonometry to convert the squares I have here to double angles. These are formulas from any book of tables. I rework them and I write cosine squared and cosine to the power of 3 as sums of cosine of multiple angles. Now, if I apply these two relationships to this, this is what I get. I get here a DC term. I get also in this one from second order distortion. I get here this coefficient from my linear term. I get some from the third order, from the odd, and also from the odd terms. And then here I get something from the second order alone, and here from the third order. This is the relationship if I put the cosine at the input. Now, if you work that further on, I rewrite this. I just take other constants. What I try to do is to normalize everything to the original fundamental wave, which is related to the input. And these constants, they are called the clear factors. Yes, that's what I did before. I want to compute the total amount of distortion. This is what causing distortion. It's him. Now here's only the DC component. Yeah, it also causes non-linearity, as I showed you before the break, the offset.
with special teeth in this. You you square them because then it's a representation of the power, and you add the squares of these ratio, and then you have a totally wrong distortion. This is gives you the amount of power in the non-linear components. You can work that out and evaluate this further on. So I remove this summation sign and I make some approximations here, because normally, not all times, you take care that this is equal, but this one you neglect this one and you end up with this one. So these are the approximations, and you can here you are have the A factors, the A scale factors back here. This expression to describe the power A non-linear distortion. This is not wrong myself. There are better pictures on the internet, by the way. This is but yeah. What I now do, I take for every constant. Yeah? This is the for the fundamental frequency. This is for 2 times the fundamental frequency, 3 times the fundamental frequency. I want to express it in decibel, so I take the 10 logarithm out of. And I compute all these things and I set them, put them in a graphic form. I put here the input, amplitude of course, in a logarithmic scale. And I put the output in a logarithmic scale, and I put them in this graphic. And I see that for the first linear term, this is the IP3 intermodulation, or just what's an IP4? It's an intermodulation product. This is IP1, this is IP2, this is from your second harmonic, and this is IP3 from your third order harmonic. Now, normally, if your amplitude is low enough, sufficiently low, then you're only dealing with this and this and even this, you will notice. But if you turn up your volume, you see that these one become more and more leading. And the first one that becomes leading is the second order. It passes here, the becomes louder than your the frequency, the frequency that you have at your input, and then that has a double frequency that becomes louder, and then after a while, then the third order harmonic from non-linear distortion overrules everything. And and this goes with 3 times the slope. So, and yeah, if you are too loud, yeah, then lost all the information. You don't notice this anymore. You only have a third order, a third degree distortion. And, interception points. That's what IP stands for. So here you have again the same picture, but now robbed from the internet. This may be clear, this is what happens. They have here the input and the output, and you have here a good linear, yes, log-log, it's linear of the original frequency, via the red one now is the two types of frequency, and is that so? No, the green one is the double frequency, and here is the triple frequency. And we did it the other way around. First you get the third order. Yeah, it depends on how you choose your, if you shift this more to this, yeah, then this will become later, but it can also become earlier. This one, then here already overrules this tone, and the other, the second order later, but if you are at this point of amplitude at the input, the only thing you hear is this one, because this will overrule everything. So. And so, non-linear distortion. Now, show you a picture about what happens to if you use two frequencies. I just take an example of 130 hertz, 150 hertz, so they're 20 hertz apart. If I put these pair of frequencies at the input, what do I get out? Get the response. Now, first I get out 0 hertz. I get the difference, of course, between the frequencies. 0 hertz, the difference. And then here I have a cluster around 130. 150, 170 megahertz, that's what you see here. I get a cluster here, around these three. And I get a cluster here. And a way to get inside how many. And of course, for the negative frequencies, it also goes. So this picture is nice and symmetric. And I did not invent this myself, by the way. Not that good. This is in the ITT Reference of Radio Engineers, the book I wrote here before. They have very good graphics about this phenomenon. And I think this shows you a lot how to predict where all this stuff is coming. But, you put here the two frequencies I put in. Then, so this axis, I put some axis higher, I put here 0, a new axis, this on the same axis, the sum, and then I construct lines, 3 times the frequency, 2 times the frequency, and I put here the frequency itself, and you can, in a graphical way, construct the position, not the amplitude, the position of the frequencies that cause nonlinear distortion and intermodulation. I put the reference data for radio engineers. I took it from this edition, 1973. There are many editions, I think the oldest from the 50s. I think for long, since the beginning of the 1990s, so ITT stopped sponsoring this book because they go for money and not for telecom. They kept their name because it sells good. They are now in cars and in hotels. They've skipped everything about telecom. They sold radio receivers consumer electronics. So Sharp Lawrence was the same company in Hollywood. They all over. This, okay, I save you. This is only if you want to do this to show you, demonstrate. If you really want to analyze this, what you have to do, what you envy. I don't envy the mathematicians who have to do this. I go back to where I stopped, and this was linearity, and continue with time invariance, and then the echte correcte term is time shifting variance. What's this story about non-linearity with clear? See no questions. It means everyone understood, or no one understood. Well, I got questions from you, so that's good. Now, time shifting variance. This is an easy property. You have input output relationship. You shift this in time, then this should shift in time the same amount. If this is not the case, then there is something strange happening. There is some blockade somewhere to here's some silly examples. What I've got here, these are time. This one is the most easy. This is just a delay line. Just a piece of line with where the input is equal to the output. This one is an amplified offset, linear, non-linear, doesn't matter, but it is time invariant. Now here I have some examples of time variant systems. Forget this one, we will get a multi-rate signal processing. This is a compression of your axis, and when you leave, when you discard samples, or your interpolate samples. This one is a very strange one. If you shift this, and this shift the other side, not the same side. This relationship is not for physical systems. This relationship is referring to non-causal systems. This is the next, the third of the four features. This one is a nice example. Here you have this multiplication, and this one is time dependent, so it's time variant. And this most simple example is this one, and this what you here do is amplitude modulation. That's what the radio amateurs do, and yeah, you just multiply with a carrier frequency F0, which is much higher than the highest frequency here, and you shift your whole spectrum, because the Fourier transform, you mean frequency shifts to a part of the band where you are not bothered or not disturbed by noise in the original band, so amplitude modulation. That shifts the carrier frequency. But this is time variant and linear. Now here the term fear filter pops up. It means finite impulse response. I refer to the first day. I put here an impulse. It goes. The impulse is shifted here every clock cycle, and then finally it vanishes. And then here, it results at the response in a sequence of pulses, of n, large n pulses, but a finite length, so finite impulse response. That's where the name comes from, it refers to the time domain properties. But only the coefficients here, or the scalars here, they're not fixed. Because the example I showed you at convolution, which is a demonstration, this is just a circuit that performs convolution. They were constants. If they are not, could be for some reason, then you have a time variant filter. How to make them time invariant? okay. You just have constant terms all over every moment. And that's what I say here. Now you replace them by h of 0, h of 1, h of n minus 1 for all discrete moments are the same. Then you have a time invariant filter. You can, because it is a linear system, by the way, applying the Fourier transform on this is
perfectly well possible.
The only thing you have to do, you have here x convolved with this, and x convolved with this, and it, you get the
computation becomes somewhat more complicated, but
it's perfectly valid. It's not a new picture.
So what you've already seen. You have the time shift invariance property in the time domain, but
you have identical or equivalent operations in the frequency domain. This is in the Z domain and this is in the discrete time Fourier transform. Shifting in time here means phase shifting, it means multiplying by this factor. And here in the Z transform, multiplying by Z to minus the number of sampling intervals that you shifted. It's here just the Z transform. And what I do here is just the Fourier transform done for the sampled signals.
Again, a repeat of the over and over again of the same information. So we get the same information 6 or 7 times. Hope and stop it in your mind. Now, I have to do something about this formula editor. Now,
okay, this is what I said. Yeah, if you can compute with the spectrum for this, but then you end up with this is the description, it's in time domain as you have it, and if you do want to do this in the frequency domain, you end up in this equation. It's not nice. It's all linear operations, you've all done it, but yeah. There's one special example.
I think it is in the next slide.
Yep, this one. If all the coefficients are 0 and only one left, and this is time variant,
then I have my amplitude modulation again. I recognize.
This is a scalar, but it changes in time. If this changes like a cosine, then I have here an amplitude modulation. If I have this whole sequence and all in some way cosine, then I have all types of amplitude modulations in parallel and adding them up. That is a special case of this now. The time invariance. The invariant filter seen it also many times before. This is the classic convolution sum, symbolic notation. You get a product, in the frequency domain it's much simpler. And this is the standard finite impulse response filter almost. I hope by this time you have recognized this structure now. It's just a tap delay line. You have a long delay line, you have taps, and you add up depths. Finite impulse response filters. Yes. What time shall we stop? 1:30. I'm not stopping here. So don't be happy. Don't let you lose it. Okay, we'll go to causality, which is the most difficult of the four features. Stability, it's also not easy to describe, but this one is rather difficult with respect to very fundamentals of the Fourier transform. fundamental properties. First, the time domain, because it's almost trivial. What is a causal system? You put here a stimulus, and the response that you get out is immediately after, at the same time, instantaneously, or sometimes after. That's normal behavior. If I put the button on my computer, it reacts instantly or some microseconds later. That's normal behavior. Non-causal behavior is that the computer starts to act before I push a button. That's not normal. But yeah, sometimes it's normal if you want to fight with someone and you want to give him a kick, and he already starts to yell because you want to kick him. That's non-causal behavior. It's, this is what if you put a step function here, and the output, if this is a linear system, or linear systems, then this should be the response, and not before. So, the explanation, the time domain is easy, causality, causal behavior. Some examples, okay, this is an impulse response system which delays all my input signals by time t0. And here I have non-causal system because you see here a minus t. If there is a minus t here, then sure that there's a non-causal system. Why do I need non-causal systems to describe, to do my analysis? They have nothing to do with physics. You can't, one of the simple checks, you cannot draw block schematic of it. I should know how to do this, to draw block schematic out of this, because, and the one, a system that is non-causal, we have done all the time by now, this is the ideal filter. The response of an ideal filter is the sink function. And the sink function starts somewhere at minus infinity. That's impossible. You have to start somewhere, and it means that you have to shift towards t is zero, the beginning of this sink pulse. But where is the beginning of this sink pulse? It is at minus infinity. So physically, ideal low-pass filter is impossible. What you can do is truncate your sink function, and after the truncation, shift, delay the sink function so that the beginning starts at t0, and the more of the ideal low-pass filter you want to preserve, the longer you have to delay the truncated sink function. So this the key example of a non-causal system, ideal low-pass filter, simply doesn't exist. Now we go to the frequency domain, and now the computations start. And I think I first give you the conclusions, and then we go, I think I fear, to the appendix again, where you can see all the evaluations. I have a causal system I want to say, what for, because if I have a causal consequence, a causal system, it has heavy consequences on my system on the spectrum. I will show that in the frequency domain. This is in time domain. Causality. How to translate causality into the frequency domain?
This restriction. Causality is a restriction.
A causal
system, say, is all impulse responses are single-sided. Because at the negative times, the time axis, it is zero. But for the positive time, for the positive time axis, something exists. So I have a single-sided impulse response. Now, remember from Fourier transforms on Tuesday, the property of symmetry, a single-sided impulse response, I can partition any signal or any impulse response in even an odd part. Correspondingly, in the spectrum, I then partition the even part becomes real, real and even, and the real and odd becomes imaginary and odd. This is how they're related. And what here's the conclusion: this even and odd part are related by the sine function. That's the conclusion of the, if you do all this computation. So if you know the even part, you don't have an even thing, you can compute the odd parts. You cannot choose them independently. And also in the spectrum, they're coupled by the Fourier transform of the sine function. Now, the real part of the spectrum and the imaginary part spectrum, you cannot choose independently. And once you know this one, the other one is known. You cannot choose them for free. It goes even further. If you have the amplitude and the phase, you can real and imaginary. You can have them in polar coordinates. You have the magnitude and the angle, amplitude and phase. The amplitude is even and the phase is odd. If you, once you have the amplitude is determined, your phase is also known. If your amplitude characteristic is known, your phase characteristic is also known for a causal system. And you saw by this non-causal system with the sync impulse response, I just assumed, okay, the phase response is not important. No, it is. If I have this sync pulse, or this ideal, with this ideal filter, filter characteristic, this ideal frequency response. The amplitude is this rectangle, but the phase, and you can compute this, looks awful. There's a picture in the appendix, and then you immediately see it's impossible to make. You have a perfect amplitude characteristic, but your phase characteristic is impossible. So the relationship between amplitude and phase characteristic, real, imaginary. Now this, I use the term single-sidedness. It's not an official term, I just invented it to make clear what happens. This one is called, this relationship, the Fourier transform sine function is called the Hilbert transform. And then I enter a complete new area of transforms, and I don't do that. I show you a glimpse of it. Then you see appendix. This is the relationship, and this is what we saw in the... Oh, the T is here, but due to this compatibility, it's one of the brackets. So you have the sine function of T, which is this, and this is explained in this fundamental pairs. Just look it up. This is plus and minus a step, and this is this hyperbolic function in the imaginary plane. Example. Now, suppose that we have a system. This is remember this capacitor resistance network, a very simple first order filter. You put an impulse at the input, then this is the impulse response. The lobe of a a high pass filter. No. Perfectly normal. Now, then this is I split this in even part and odd part. This is the even part, and this is the odd function. Now, now these are coupled. You can by the sine function. If you multiply this by this sine function, then you get this one, and vice versa. If you take this one by the sine function, then you get this back. Coupled by the sine function. Now, in the frequency domain, it means, and of course, this is much harder. This, of course, becomes real and even, and this becomes imaginary and odd. This is the omega. They are coupled by the convolution of the frequency response of the sine function. This is multiplication, this becomes convolution. Now this is hard to see. And this is symbolic, but if you really evaluate it, this becomes horrible integrals. This is how mathematical textbook presented as an integral. It's some mystic, it is not. It's this relationship. And okay, you add this up and you get such a frequency characteristic. This is how it looks like, and this is one of the what I call fundamental pairs that I described in the second day. So here you have the single-sidedness, and here, that means it, and here you have between here and imaginary the Hilbert transform relationship, and which is nothing else than convolution with this function. Okay, if you really evaluate this, you get this horrible integrals. There's again an example. I don't know why I did this. But, this is double-sided negative exponential, and I think I. Okay, let's go. Yeah, I already see why I did this. This is the real part. Okay, this is in formula what was in the pictures in the previous slide. This is the formula explanation. This relation, this is time domain, single-sidedness, Hilbert transform relation, Hilbert transform. These are related by times sine t. This is the real part, e to the power, this is e to the power of sine. This is this odd function. Now, corresponding frequency domain, this is the real and even part, this is the imaginary odd part. This comes from this, this comes from this. And these parts, you tried out on a rainy afternoon or so, is related by this. If you do the convolution with this, you get this. If you do the convolution with this, you get this back. It's a one-to-one relationship. It's just like the Fourier transform. This is the Hilbert transform relationship. Another example. Maybe this is more clear. The complex harmonic. You have this, now I start in the frequency domain. I show you that the other, because of duality, if I have single-sidedness in the frequency domain, I have the Hilbert transform in the time domain. Yeah, so single-sided frequency spectrum. Here I have the complex harmonic. I can split this up in an even part and in an odd part. And you already feel what's going to happen, because if you do the Fourier transform, they are related by the sine, and this is quite obvious. If you multiply this by this sine function, then this this goes to this one, and if you multiply this by the sine function, this will flip to the negative part. No. Single sidedness. If you take the Fourier transform of this one, it is cosine. Even function, even in real. If you take this one, you have g times cosine. Yeah? Imaginary and odd, in frequency spectrum. Sorry, in the time domain spectrum. So this is frequency spectrum, this is time domain. Sine, g sine, and cosine are related by Hilbert transform. That's what happening, and that's also this representation. Cosine and sine are related. It's one of the fundamental pairs of the Hilbert transform. If there are more, you can have a whole table of functions from the Hilbert transform. It's another area for investigation. So sine and cosine is a key example how they are related by minus 90 degrees phase shift. That is the Hilbert transform for the phase shifter and with a very strange phase shifter. What you do here is phase shift, then phase shift of 90 degrees, wide band. Not for a second. Wide band 90 degrees phase shifter. A linear phase shifter is easy. Wide band, because there's a simple delay line. But a 90 degrees phase shift, which is a phase shift which is constant over all frequencies. Analog, the circuit is not realizable. The digital it is. Is the solution. Maybe on Friday afternoon when you're all overflowed with information, I will show you how it can be done. And then all the tricks that you've got come together there. That is a solution. Okay, this is a repeat of the previous slide, and now I also have the other, the cosine sine example, also put here, and you see what I did here, what I do here. I try to put them together, and you can see what happens. Now, main thing that you want to remember, you have here a single-sided signal, and a Hilbert relationship between imaginary and real. The dual case is if I have a single-sided spectrum, we have a Hilbert domain relationship in the time domain. This is the duality property again of the Fourier transform. Now, I don't go through all the formulas. Okay. See the pictures. The review of. I think I skip this. This is the appendix, by the way, so it doesn't tell you anything new. I gave this table of all these elementary properties, and you might get confused because if I multiply here some time signal with a sine function, I have to do 1 to the power of g pi f convolved with this. This is Hilbert transform. This is how the integral looks. This is only symbolic notation. This is what I have to solve. I don't like that. So, I also had a formula there showing this. And you get 1 over g2 pi f times this function. This is something you have in a phase or computing with these phases and these coils and these capacitors in this network. Integration. If you integrate here in time domain, you multiply, you divide by g omega. So you see, they're not the same, of course, but they have a tiny difference, essential difference. This is convolution, this is multiplication. And the same goes for the other. You have here the, if you have a sine function here, then you have here the convolution. And you have the integral in the frequency domain, you have here the multiplication. it's the same factor, but the convolution and multiplication is a hell of a difference.
It's certainly not the same.
This is emphasized. The formulas look similar, but you look completely different things.
Okay. Shall we do it or shall we? This is the most difficult part of my story for this set of slides. Causality. Single-sidedness, Hilbert transform. These are the keywords. Yeah, they're coupled. The one domain, the other domain. Keep, yeah, and keep the pictures in mind and the formulas. Coupled to this, enormous computation. Okay, can you make a beginning of stability? This is less difficult. It is straightforward, and see how far we can get.
I think we can do a lot of it. This is the formula that operates.
By wet finger method, you can already hear what the stability means in the time domain. Now, if I have a limited input here with limited amplitude, I expect here an output with limited amplitude. If for some reason here this explodes, I have a system which is not stable. This is
called bounded input, bounded output in the textbooks. And if you make a notation formally, it means that the energy, now the impulse response converges to zero, and you compute the integral. It is a finite integral, finite area. And not go. If this is a step function, then it goes to infinity. Step function is on the edge of instability. Now, the example I have is yes, that's what I have. Here I have a signal. This is from Laplace transform, in fact. What I have here is a harmonic, a complex harmonic. It's this, but also in time. Some amplitude here. The amplitude of the complex harmonic is either becoming smaller, it converges to zero. Yes, sigma is smaller than zero, then you have e to the power of minus the sigma, then it is decreasing in time. It is exploding in time, it is increasing exponential, or if this sigma is zero, then the amplitude remains constant. Then you have the complex harmonic going on forever. Boundless energy. But limited power, boundless energy. Here are several functions that we've seen that have finite power, but infinite energy. This is a class of functions that is on the edge of stability. It's not really stable, but also not exploding. This class of Laplace transform, I don't want it. Repeat again that first about the system. I have an example here of a finite impulse response filter. I start with finite because it is h of zero, and the last coefficient is hn minus 1, so I have a length n impulse response, and this the difference equation, that's how I call it, of the input output relation. No. difficult to manipulate this.
Now I go back to this geometric sequence. I hope you remember this from yesterday or the day before yesterday. You have this.
I now take for this coefficient a geometric sequence. This is 1, a squared, and so on, a to the n minus 1. And I'm going to rewrite this. Yeah, okay, this is then the impulse response. Impulse response. Like this. This is my finite impulse response. If I now take rewrite this, or take another other stimulus and get another response, then okay, I do this. I can scale the response, zoals the linearity. I can delay this by 1, and then the equation looks like this. But all the factors are multiplied by a, and the all the elements are shifted by minus 1. Then I get this one. Now, if I subtract this, and then I am it results in the equation as it is here. Output minus scaled and delayed version of the output is equal to the first pulse of the stimulus and the minus scaled and delayed version of the last direct pulse of the stimulus. And okay, rewriting this, put all the put this part to the other. Then we have an equation that gives something that in the examples of linearity. Here the output is a function of the input and the delayed version of the input, and also a delayed version of the output. Here is a feedback loop visible. We come to manipulate this one step further. So you have here, okay, this is then the impulse response, how it looks like. You put the impulse in here, here's the impulse, here's the impulse. This one is the, so the impulse response is impulse at the input plus a delayed scaled version of the impulse response itself. Now I make an assumption, because here I I make the assumption now that this geometric sequence is converging to zero for large powers of alpha. I do this shit, and when I do that, I can, then this goes to zero, and then I end up with this equation. And this is a very simple equation, so it means my output is a function of my delayed output plus an input. And if I have written it, this is this then goes to infinity. Eh? This is not finite anymore, this is an infinite impulse response. But I can then rewrite it in this way. This is called an infinite impulse response field of order 1. Eh? So we can rework the finite impulse response field order n minus 1 towards an infinite impulse response field with order 1. I owe you the block schematics. The choice of this alpha determines whether this
response explodes or not. If this is smaller than one, then every time a smaller fraction of my response is fed back into my into the input. And for if it is larger than one, then this fraction is larger, larger, larger until the smoke comes out of the system. And if it is one, then you keep on feeding the same amount of my response back into the input. This is at the boundary of stability. Let me now, I finish this with drawing the block schematic, because stift. And we shall draw two block schematics. Here I one is, and I refer also to the examples that we did this morning already. I do this x1 and then plus alpha x and minus 1. Just for reference. So how to transform this in a block schematic? Now, you start, of course, you start with the black box. That's how our engineers start. You start with the black box, and I have here IN, and I have here X of N. Okay. Arrow in, input, output. So the output is a sum of the input plus a scaled version of the delayed input. I put here a D, a delay element, not a flip-flop, a delay element. It's abstract, it's arithmetic. If you realize this, then it becomes a whole battery of D flip-flops to transform a binary number. So this is the box schematic corresponding with this input-output relationship. Now the other one. The only thing I did is replace now the x with the I, and this represents a feedback. How does the box schematic look now? Again, okay, the black box approach. We have some output IN and an input XN. What is IN? Put it a bit. Okay, put it a bit like this. It is XN plus, and now I take a tab here and I put a delay element here. I take a tap the response, I delay it one cycle. I can delay it one cycle and then add it. And this is now the block schematic. Now you see the dramatic difference. This is feed forward, this is finding the response. Stability, no problem. Always stable. You can never explode because the response ends at a certain time. But here you have this loop. And sometimes I have
write the DS here, the sampling interval, because of course this is this clock. The clock is here. At the minimum. Now you see what happens if this is smaller than one, then this eventually this loop in the clocked time will vanish. If this is wait a minute, I forgot something. There is a scaling factor here, and here there is also a scaling factor, which is essential. But here it doesn't matter. This is just a scaled delayed version, and here you have also a scaled and delayed version. The scaling is essential. If this is smaller than one, then the signal that's present here in the feedback loop goes to zero. So, and yes, but if this is larger than one, then the response that you get here is amplified back and amplified again, and until smoke comes out of your system. Yeah, that's the end of life. Then. So feedback systems, this is called a finite impulse response filter, order one. I put it because it is one delay element, and this is called an infinite impulse response filter of order one. Now, this is to conclude what I've written down here. The box schematics are missing in the slides, but this is the essential of stability, and now we have two key examples to compare, that you can compare how to analyze stability. This is the most simple analysis, and I think this is all about stability. There's nothing more to say at this moment. Yes, that is. Shall I do that here? No, this is something for the afternoon. Outside scope, people who have the Laplace transform immediately see what I mean. I postpone this for the afternoon, because you can make from this. This is the time domain description, this is the block schematic. The other, this is one and two. From this, normally you do the Z transform. IZ. And just apply the holes. This is XZ. This is one. XZ plus alpha. And the time delay is times z minus 1 times xz. And if you rework this, you get 1 plus alpha z minus 1 times xz. And of course, this means the h of z, which is az. Divided by xz is 1 plus alpha z minus 1. And this transfer function is the reference for doing computations by poles and zeros. And also for a frequency characteristic. You can also go from time domain directly to frequency characteristic, but you can also go from your transfer function to your frequency characteristic.
I've sort of writing down the other. Equals and x z plus alpha times a. Oh, z minus 1, sorry, z minus 1 times anything minus 1. Okay, and now I have to solve this, or to write this as a ratio of x and z. Now I do something else. I write a z minus a times 2 on one side, alpha times z minus 1 times a z is x z. And then h of z, which is a z divided by xz, is 1 divided by 1 minus alpha z minus 1, and wait a minute, take the red one again, because this is important, so this one. Here we have this one, and for pole zero analysis, I rewrite this I multiply this with z, and I get z minus alpha, this alpha, and here I multiply this by z, I get this one z, so z plus alpha, and then the denominator z. These are leaving points for all zero analysis. And that is now we're already running ahead of what's going to come in the last set of slides. Okay, it's no problem. For analysis of digital filters, or any filters in fact, also analog filters, you have four things to four leaving points. One is the time domain description. Means the input-output relationship, either the described by the impulse response, you have the transfer function, so right here, which describes all zeros. You have the frequency characteristic, which is not here, but you can easily, you can mathematically derive from this. And you can also mathematically or graphically derive from this. I'll show you the graphic method. And you get the engineering quick and dirty feeling how to do this. And the fourth part is what you see here is the block schematic. These four things are the four aspects for complete analysis of a filter, analog and digital. Does it matter? Time domain description. The complex frequency domain, description z-domain, or Laplace domain. Then the familiar frequency characteristic from Laplace transform, or discrete time Laplace transform. En de block schematic. But these four points, and there is one still missing. If this is one, and then this is obvious four. And this is 2. I miss number 3, frequency characteristic. We skip that to the afternoon. This is the and pulse zeros, that is the picture what you see here. So don't be frightened what you see, it's totally new. No, it's not. Forget for a moment about this. You have to focus here. But that. This is how Fourier and transform and Z-transform are related. I told you how the mapping went. It was this mapping. The P-plane, complex P-plane is mapped to the complex Z-plane. And the relation is e to the power of P. And
a rectangular grid here in the P-plane, like this, is distorted into the unit circle. What is an infinity in the Laplace domain is concentrated in zero here. That is the vertical lines like this, they distort to circles. Here you also recognize the periodicity. Laplace domain is famous about continuous signals, a periodic spectrum. The Z domain refers to sampled signals that have periodic spectrum. And the construction, I can also say, tell you the last secret, but we'll come at this tomorrow. If you have here, this is the complex plane. If you have a perpendicular here, an axis, which represents the amplitude of your transfer function, or your frequency characteristic, your transfer function, then you put a blanket over the P-plane, which gives a pole a zero description, and if you cut through this blanket, then where the blanket intersects with the plane through this axis, you have the frequency characteristic. And the same goes here you put a blanket, also zero, and you have here the transfer function. You take the intersection with this blanket with the cylinder put here, you have your periodic frequency characteristic. This is how you see graphically, so graphically you can see what happens. I think we stop here. Quarter to one.